దేశంలోని పిల్లలందరికీ నాణ్యమైన విద్యను అందించడం అనే కృషిని జాతీయ స్థాయిలో ఒక ఉద్యమంలా చేపట్టాలని ప్రముఖ సంక్షేమ ఆర్థికవేత్త జాన్ డ్రెస్ సూచించారు. లేకుంటే అనేక లోపాలు అవలక్షణాలతో నాశనమైన మన పాఠశాల వ్యవస్థను మెరుగుపరచడం సాధ్యం కాదని ఈనాడు ఈటీవీ భారత్లకు ఇచ్చిన ఇంటర్వ్యూలో తెలిపారు. దేశంలో ప్రస్తుతం ప్రాథమిక విద్యాస్థాయి నుంచి నెలకొన్న లోపాలు ఆర్థిక సాంఘిక అసమానతలను పెంచుతున్నాయని ఆయన విశ్లేషించారు. దేశం సమగ్రంగా అభివృద్ది చెందాలంటే పిల్లలందరికీ నాణ్యమైన విద్యను అందించడం కీలకమని ప్రపంచంలో ఎన్నో దేశాల అనుభవం దీనిని నిరూపిస్తోందని జాండ్రెజ్ అన్నారు.
Even after the 74 years of independence, India is home to 1 in every 3 illiterate adults in the world. India currently has nearly 30 crore illiterates. What is the root cause of this failure in the education sector?
Well, I would say that insofar as there is a root cause, it seems to me to be the indifference of the privileged classes towards the education of poor children, especially of Dalit and Adivasi children. This year itself, we are seeing several dramatic examples of this indifference. For instance, the school education budget was reduced this year by about 10%, even though the overall budget of the central government was increased by almost 20%. So this is an extraordinary budget cut, and there was no discussion of it. Similarly, the country going today through catastrophic education emergency, with children being shut out of schools for almost 2 years and being quite unprepared now to go back to school and to be enrolled in a grade 2 years ahead of where they were enrolled earlier. That requires a lot of preparation and thought and discussion and, of course, also expenditure. But none of that is happening on a significant scale.
Nearly 40% of our children go to private schools at a primary level, when compared to below 10% in so many developed nations. What kind of implications do you see because of this?
So that's right. I think the Indian public is not sufficiently aware of the fact that around the world, it is the norm in most countries for most children to go to government schools or sometimes to private non-commercial schools, private non-profit schools. So the figure you gave of, you know, 10% in developed, it's not just in developed nations, it's basically across the world. In India and a few other countries, it's very different. The proportion of children going to private schools, which usually would mean a commercial profit-oriented private school, is more than a third now and growing every year. And that is only one of the divisions that we see in the education system. On top of that, of course, there is a lot of stratification within the private system, with some of the low-fee private schools being of as bad or even worse quality, with government schools in the remoter areas for underprivileged children being really virtually dysfunctional, and then some of the better government schools like the Navodaya schools being very good. So we have multiple stratification in the education system. And the main consequence of that is that the education system produces the inequalities, the economic and social inequalities.
Yeah, you said social inequalities. Education, how to address this problem?
I think this is a big challenge because it will take nothing less than a major sustained national movement to repair it and to ensure that all children get quality education. I think one thing we have learned in recent years is that when the political leadership at the top throws its weight behind something, usually things start moving. We have seen it, for example, in the sanitation campaign. We have seen it in the reform of the public distribution system. We have seen it this year in the vaccination campaign. Yeah. So I think one can hope that if a similar commitment could be shown over a period of time, not just for a short period of a few months or a year, and a real national effort was made to bring better quality to the education system, I think we could make progress, you know, because there has been a fair amount of research in recent years on the schooling system and how it can be improved. So we have some ideas. For instance, we know that one of the major problems in the government schooling system in India is that children, even within the same school and the same class, are at very different levels of learning. And so those who are left behind find it difficult to keep up with the rest of the class. Yeah. And we know that one way of reducing this problem of diversity and inequality within the classroom would be to have better preschool education. But again, the preschool education budget this year was reduced. Yeah. So we would need a big investment in preschool education to start addressing that problem. In Jharkhand, where I live, teachers in entire blocks are supposed to be supervised or supported by so-called block resource persons who have much lower qualifications and much lower salaries. So there are too many aberrations in the schooling system. So I think what we need is to put more emphasis, give more attention, more resources, both economic resources and political resources, and make it a sustained movement over years. And then we can hope that things will change quite substantially.
Earlier this year, you conducted a survey of 1400 underprivileged children and their families across the country with student volunteers. What were the main findings of this survey?
So one of the main findings was that online education is a fiction as far as poor children is concerned. We found that in rural areas among underprivileged families, only 8% of children were studying online regularly. This is very important to say, even though it may be obvious to some of your viewers, because the central government keeps giving the impression that online education saved the day during the lockdown and the COVID crisis. That may be true for a small minority of privileged children, mainly in urban areas, but it is not at all true for the vast majority of poor children. Earlier, we conducted a very simple reading test as part of this survey. We asked children to read a very simple sentence. And in rural areas, among these offline children, among those enrolled in class three, only 25% could read that sentence. So now the situation is that these children have forgotten a lot of what they had learned earlier, but they are being promoted 2 years ahead of the grade where they were enrolled before the COVID crisis. And that creates an urgent need for radical provisions to make it possible for these children to continue studying and not become de facto dropouts.
What kind of changes in approach do you suggest the school should make in their curriculum and pedagogy to deal with the present crisis?
I think what is most important is to realize the gravity of the situation and to avoid shortcuts. We have to realize the immensity of the gap that separates poor children today from the curriculum of the grade in which they are enrolled. I think that either the curriculum needs to be drastically simplified or the children have to be given more time. A few days ago, I was talking to a teacher in a school in Chhattisgarh, talking about these children who had forgotten what they had learned earlier. She said, "I cannot do anything for these children because I cannot slow down the entire class for them." That is exactly the kind of attitude that I think we have to avoid. We have to make those children our priority and redesign the system for them rather than to consider them as de facto dropouts.
We have so many goals on the economic front. For example, our government announced a target to develop our economy to $5 trillion level by 2025. Is it possible to our country to achieve these kind of huge targets as our performance is very poor in educating our population? Are education and economic development not connected?
Well, of course they are connected. I think this goal of India becoming a $5 trillion economy by 2025 is best ignored. I mean, it's just rhetoric. There's no conceivable scenario where this could possibly be achieved. And secondly, I think that in any case, what we need to focus on is not economic growth, or at least not just economic growth, but development. Development is not just more US dollars. Development means that people live better, that they are better nourished, they are better educated, they live longer, they have more freedoms. And of course, if the economy is growing well, that can help. But only if the resources are used to improve the lives of poor people. So I think we have to think of development and not just growth. And if we think of development, then yes, of course, education is perhaps the most important thing. It's important in itself because education is part of the quality of life. We have learned most reliably in the last 20 years in development economics. And so that's another reason for giving far more importance to education and especially to elementary education.
Sir, which countries are moving in correct direction in educational field among the developing countries? What can we learn from them?
Most countries in Asia, outside South Asia, have given a lot of importance to education, invested in schooling at an early stage of development, and are now reaping the benefits of it. I mean, that would apply to most of East Asia, including China, Vietnam, and closer to home, Myanmar, for example. There are countries even within South Asia that we can learn from. For example, Sri Lanka, which is far ahead of India in the field of elementary education. And incidentally, not many people in India may know that almost all schools in Sri Lanka are government schools. In fact, the private schools were nationalized a few decades ago, and there are very few of them today. There are some, but not many. Most children learn in government or government-sponsored schools. So I'm not saying we can do the same in India. It may be too late for that kind of step, but it's an inspiration we can take of a radical step, cardinal importance of elementary education for development. By the way, we can also learn not just from other countries, but also from some of the Indian states that have given adequate importance to education. For example, Kerala, much before independence, Tamil Nadu, very soon after independence, gave a big push to elementary education and is again reaping the benefits of it. And then later on, Himachal Pradesh in the early 1970s, when it became an independent state, gave tremendous importance to elementary education.